There have been a few articles published on Huffington Post by contributors in the last few weeks that are very interesting. This one by Leslie Keene, contributor, investigative journalist and author, former manager of DoD Aerospace Threat Program, says, quote, UFOs are real. And it says, something extraordinary was revealed today. Former high-level officials and scientists with deep black experience who have always remained in the shadows came forward on one platform. These insiders have long-standing connections to government agencies, which may have programs investigating unidentified aerial phenomenon, UAP or UFOs. The team includes a 25-year veteran of the CIA's Directorate of Operations, a Lockheed Martin Program Director for Advanced Systems at Skunk Works, and a former Deputy Assistant Secretary of Defense for Intelligence. So high-level people are a part of this organization called To the Stars Academy of Arts and Science. And what is it? It is a public benefit corporation which will advance research in unexplained phenomena and develop related technologies. And it establishes three synergistic divisions, science, aerospace, and entertainment. And they quote Tom DeLonge, the CEO of this company. We believe there are discoveries within our reach that will revolutionize the human experience. Now, we've tracked Tom DeLonge before in his interest in UFOs, his clear connection to Freemasonry, and the article goes on to talk about DeLonge's relationship with some of these high-level military intelligence officers, which interestingly were revealed in some of the WikiLeaks documents in the last year. And so here's a couple things to point out from the article. One of the members at the most recent meeting for this was Luis Elizondo, who, according to this article, ran an important program at the DoD. He was the senior career intelligence officer whose experience includes working with the U.S. Army, the Department of Defense, the National Counterintelligence Executive, and the Director of National Intelligence. It says he served as the director for the National Program's Special Management Staff in the Office of the Secretary of Defense. He is also the former director of programs to investigate UATs for the Office of the Secretary of Defense. Quote, Lou will architect partnerships with some very sensitive places to help protect us and the technology involved so we may achieve for you the extraordinary, DeLonge said at today's event. Now, I find this all very fascinating. Think about the timing of this rollout here. We have all this stuff going on with the hurricanes and the weather, the earthquakes, the fires. But if we step back and look back about 2 years, I made some videos talking about Hillary Clinton, Tom DeLonge, talking about UFOs, the whole secret space program thing, where I actually wrote a book about it and never published it. And I'll get to that in a moment because something interesting popped up in the last couple weeks that I want to share with you as part of this. But one thing to point out is that the name that kept popping up was John Podesta. And John Podesta's name was tied to UFO stuff for years. And his interest in UFOs is definitely clear. Is he one of the people talking to Tom DeLonge? I find it fascinating that those names became highly politically charged scapegoats, especially Podesta, given the whole Pizzagate thing blowing wide open, especially with the community of people looking for the truth, where the people in the public just accept that this guy is just a normal guy, oh, he's getting attacked by fake news and all this nonsense. And certainly the connection to the Democratic Party and Hillary Clinton and her ties to the Rockefeller Ranch and, you know, reading about UFOs and all this stuff, it's all very interesting. And if you think about presidents and their public appearances, what's the big question they always ask? What about UFOs? What about Area 51? What about Roswell?
All the classified files on the UFOs. Because I want to know. I want to know what has been going on. Did you do that?
Sort of.
You know, my ikker on really what to, you know, this subhanAllah agenda is in full swing. During the exit of this system, like I've mentioned, they're looking to stage World War III, an economic collapse, and a false extraterrestrial contact. That false extraterrestrial contact will be the biggest, single most biggest fitting since the demise of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam on the Ummah. You can mark my words on this, and this will be the biggest regret. The ulama ikram, especially those who've been keeping up to speed with the science PDF and related content. This will be the biggest fitness since, until the appearance of Dajjal La'anatu Llahi Alayhi, the Antichrist, who will be, I mean, this will be the prologue, it will be almost an introduction as a piece of psychological conditioning for the Ummah in order for them to embrace and accept Dajjal La'anatu Llahi Alayhi as a extraterrestrial being who has visited Earth as a sentient being, and his race being the ones responsible for creating humanity, creating Adam and Hawa by splicing their own genome with that of the Homo erectus. We've discussed this, right? And by virtue of them filling the void and the gap that the paleontological records have found between the Homo erectus and humans. And this is going to be the Sumerian gods, which I've discussed with you guys, which is in Iraq, in Sumer, subhanAllah, Babylon. And is it any, I mean, subhanAllah, if you think about it, there's a huge pattern emerging where the Dajjal La'anatu Llahi Alayhi will be revealed to the world from Isfahan, right, which is in Iran, which is next to Iraq. Iraq is where Sumer is. And from what I understand, with what they're intending to do in terms of World War III, they will, after North Korea, after they nuked North Korea, they will nuke, right, Iran, right? So Iran will be leveled down to a pile of rubble, right? And interesting enough, then this fool will come along as the savior, the Dajjal La'anatu Llahi Alayhi, and he will appear in Isfahan, where I guess the suffering will be at its pinnacle, right? And then march on through Iraq all the way up to our third Haramain, right? And it's interesting, and the ulama ikram need to consider this, why that place and why that location. Well, from what I understand, and again, this is just another pattern that's emerging, and I don't think there's any serendipity or any coincidence there. But from what we understand, Adam alayhi salam, when he was had descended and has was expelled from paradise, he was sent to Sri Lanka, right, in India, and then Mahawa in Arabia, and lo and behold, Iblis La'anatu Llahi Alayhi in Iraq, right? And it's interesting how Iraq seems to be at the center of this, of these Sumerian sky gods. Sky gods, there's a relationship between Iblis La'anatu Llahi Alayhi descending, right, being expelled and sent down to earth, coming down from heaven to earth. And when I say heaven, I'm not referring to paradise here, but from another cosmic region and down to earth, subhanAllah. And then you've got these Sumerian sky gods, and then you've got Babylon, you've got Namrud, La'anatu Llahi Alayhi, and how he claimed to be God, and then you've got Egypt, which is going to tie in very closely to all of this. And I've discussed this at length in a vlog where we discuss how the pyramids worldwide are going to be somehow assimilated and incorporated into this psyop of trying to convince the world on extraterrestrial beings, and how they'll claim that these pyramids were actually designed archaeologically, created and made by these extraterrestrial beings with these amazing abilities. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best again, but I mean, it's certainly very disconcerting. You can see it all come together and piece up, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. But seriously, the ulama ikram really have to address the ummah on this now. We have to grapple with this issue and just address it. That there's no gunjais for this in our deen, none whatsoever, and it's false, and it seems that there's a very dark force behind it, and it's going to tie in, I understand at least, that it's going to tie into the Dajjal La'anatu Llahi Alayhi.
So first I had people go look at the records on Area 51 to make sure there was no alien down there.
If you saw that there were aliens there, would you tell us?
Yeah.
You would.
So, is there really a book of secrets?
That's a secret.
Yeah.
What would be in the book of secrets?
If aliens are real.
Yeah, well, the truth is, Macy, we haven't actually made direct contact with aliens yet.
The aliens won't let it happen. They reveal all their secrets. They exercise strict control over us.
Did you look? Did you see? Did you explore?
I can't reveal anything.
Oh, really?
because President Clinton said he did go right in and he did check and there was nothing.
Well, you know, that's what we're instructed to say.
So my understanding is that the shayateen in jinn are being reinvented and introduced to the ummah as extraterrestrial beings. This is my understanding. So when they talk about alien, what they're referring to is the shayateen in jinn, which is the demons, right? Subhanallah. And Iblis landed alayhi at the helm of that.
Did you go through the secret files, the UFO documents? Would you be allowed to tell your daughters what was in those files?
No.
You would not?
No.
Now that you're out of office, you can do anything you want, right?
True, yeah. But I'm not telling you.
You're not telling me. You're not telling me what? Are you not telling me that you looked at them?
I'm not telling you nothing.
And you never write about them?
No.
Maybe at a time in your life, no. You're like, oh, I'm 90, I'm going to do it.
No.
No, nothing.
Well, I'm gonna do it again.
Why not?
Right? And you know, there's a new name. It's unexplained aerial phenomenon. Well, if there is something there, unless it's a, you know, threat to national security, I think we ought to share it with the public.
Well, what if everybody's all hopped up on medical marijuana and everybody gets paranoid? I would love it.
But isn't it interesting that with this Trump presidency, the topic of UFOs is bizarrely silent? No talk about UFOs or aliens or Area 51 or, hey, now that you're the president, can you look into this stuff? That question, I don't think, has been asked. Maybe it has somewhere. I haven't dug around really to look for it. But very interesting that it's so quiet on that front. But there might be a reason why. And this is all just speculation at this point, but I find it fascinating. Now, as soon as Trump was sworn into office back in January, InfoWars and Alex Jones started pumping out this idea that Trump is going to release secret technology, suppressed technology. He's going to release it for the masses.
Because their world government was admittedly about austerity and starving people and eugenics and anti-human and was a breakaway civilization where they steal all the treasure of humanity and give it to themselves, not us. Now, here's how Trump's going to beat them. And they know this, and it's why they're so scared. The United States is going to end up dominating the planet out of this, but not out of military force and not out of coercion, not out of dirty trick squads, but off of turning on the engine of liberty and deploying the incredibly advanced technologies that DARPA and our top scientists and others have developed and that have also been stolen from everybody else, that were meant to be farmed out to select global corporations to destroy the nation state. Trump is planning on distributing these technologies fairly to everyone, but having the United States have the key dominant role, because we built it all, the UK, Germany, the US, if you want to get down to it, like 90% of it, everything, okay? And then France and others were involved, but just if you got the main engine of innovation, and the Japanese and Chinese have done a lot too, but nobody can deny, the internet, all of it, atomic weapons, it just goes on and on. We're the leaders. And instead of this all being shelved as disruptive technology, Trump is preparing to roll it out. Now, they're desperate because they're going to kill tyranny with prosperity.
Interesting verbiage there, right? And if we look at a couple pieces of data that go back to the whole storyline of the secret space program in the 20th century, we see Trump's name come up in two key places that suggest some sort of connection to secret technology. And maybe this is really the war between two factions going after or trying to establish or recreate or reverse engineer or whatever this level of technology. Now, a friend and colleague, Stan Deo, who's been really on top of this kind of research and has experienced quite a bit in his life, as soon as Trump was elected, he sent me this link to this video, which now has 9,000 views, but at the time it only had a couple hundred, and it was talking about Professor John Trump. Let me play the video for you. It says here, Professor Emeritus John George Trump, 1907 to 1985, American electrical engineer, inventor, and physicist. Note, Professor Trump was President Donald Trump's brilliant uncle, whom he loved and still admires greatly. And there's Stan Deo to the right there. This is 1982 in Boston. Dr. John Trump interviewed by Stan Deo. In 1982, this is Stan Deo talking, interviewed Professor John G. Trump in Boston while filming a documentary on the life of Nikola Tesla. Professor Trump told me he was called in by the FBI to examine all the papers left behind by Tesla in his hotel New York room, number 3327, and in the hotel safe. Interesting, 33 and 27. Interesting that 33 is obviously the Masonic number there, 27 equals 9, which 9 itself seems to be the number that unlocks this sort of free energy because it collapses in on itself. Any multiple of 9 always adds back up to 9 if you add the integers. Here's the Tesla room, 3327. Tesla left a parcel wrapped in brown paper in the safe downstairs with the hotel staff. It was surely against the back rent he owed the hotel. Tesla told the staff, quote, "Do not open this parcel. It contains the secret to a superweapon." Fearing they may trigger a booby trap, the FBI asked Professor Trump to open the parcel. Professor Trump told me that FBI agents hid behind the marble pillars in the lobby while he stood alone at the counter with the suspicious parcel in front of him. Professor Trump had a twinkle in his eye and a wry smile as he told me about those brave FBI agents. Professor Trump said the parcel was wrapped in brown paper tied with twine. He looked for tripwires. After finding none and feeling no raised areas under the paper, he decided to cut the string. Next, he gently slipped a knife under a flap in the paper and removed the paper to find a beautifully finished wooden box with brass latches. Again, he looked for any tripwires around the lid before he decided to lift the lid slowly. As he did, a device was revealed. It was a decade resistance box used to measure electrical capacitance, inductance, and resistance. It used a binary method developed by Sir Charles Wheatstone to match unknown values against known values. The method known as the Playfair cipher was also used by the British and Australians in both World War I and World War II to pass coded messages. Professor Trump looked for any messages or diagrams that might be designs for a superweapon, but found none. He breathed a sigh of relief and told the FBI agents they could safely approach. Then I told Professor Trump I knew what the missing message was. Tesla left the function of the decade resistance box in his message. Its function pointed to Tesla's method of extracting electrical energy from the upper atmosphere. Tesla knew that by matching impedances between an insulated antenna and the atmosphere, one can draw limitless energy directly from the sun using vibrations in the atmosphere from the solar wind, discovered in 1859 by British astronomer Richard Carrington. Professor Trump told me about his research into high-voltage capacitors and how the atmosphere was a dielectric medium between the ionosphere and the surface of Earth. He told me how much physical force manifested in the atmosphere between the varying high voltages of the ionosphere and the Earth's surface. I realized as the charged particles of solar wind strike the upper atmosphere, they create shock waves in the atmosphere which can be siphoned off and used as a clean, limitless, renewable energy source. Thank you, Professor John G. Trump and Nikola Tesla. And it goes into a device that Standeo actually patented back in 2007 based on this technology and information. Now that makes me wonder. In light of all this geoengineering, weapons engineering, North Korea, the EMP threat, everything else, it's really interesting that John G. Trump, a relative of Donald Trump, had access to this stuff. And obviously, for people looking at this, it's not anything new. This has been sort of put out there in the world of conspiracy analysts and things like that. So again, nothing new, nothing crazy. But the other part of it that's really interesting is the potential connection of Trump to even further back to the airship mysteries. Now, I was listening to the episode with Walter Bosley, Trump, Tesla, Secret Spaceship, and NIMSA, and he actually touched on something that I wrote about in the book that's not published a couple years ago. Actually, in 2014 now. Crazy, it's been 3 years. And that's about the whole airship mysteries. Here's an actual copy of the book, guys. I mean, it's not edited, it's not finished, but here it is. And if you do a word search for Del Shaw, here it is, the Del Shaw design. And I talk about this interesting person named Del Shaw who made some paintings of airships. He was part of the Sonora Aero Club, which was a secretive group out of California that claimed to have been responsible for the creation of arrows or flying machines. And he had a notebook, which he worked on tirelessly for the last 20 years of his life, where he drew and recorded in code and bad English and German, with watercolor and everything else, depictions of the vehicles that he worked on while he was with the Sonora Aero Club, where he claims that he joyfully ruled the skies over the gold rush of California. And I wrote back then, historians have been able to trace most of the whereabouts of Del Shaw from his immigration into the United States, his occupation, his marriage, and his death. but there seems to be a gap between the years of 1856 and 1861. These are the years that Delshaw claims were responsible for his aerial exploits. So here's why I had to go back and look at what I wrote back in 2014, because what the Walter Bosley episode on the Higher Side Chats reminded me of was that, let me just quote what I wrote here, pages from the notebook have now become a collector's item for art enthusiasts worldwide. His illustrations contained nearly 100 different designs of aero crafts with very interesting names, from Aero Mayo, Aero Trump, Aero Schnabel, Aero Mary, and even Aero Jordan. Now let me show you some of these paintings. Here's one of them where you see the Trump on the bottom right. And here's another one where you clearly see Aero Trump. Which, interestingly, all of these have Houston, Texas as the location where I think these were drawn, which again is very interesting given Hurricane Harvey and what it did with the devastation. And then this one is probably the most bold, where you have Trump written clearly right there in the red, white, blue striped banner, written in yellow. Some people have said this doesn't look like a flying craft, it's more like a bus or something. Which is possible. Some of those designs did have more of a car shape, but again, they were considered flying machines, and that's what Delshaw was drawing. So, a couple questions to wrap up this video. One, what's up with all this Trump history? Is there more going on to the Trump family line than we are told? And that rabbit hole really leads to a lot of different questions when you start thinking about it.
Interesting, he should mention that I've done a vlog where we've discussed how his bloodline actually goes back to a British royalty. Okay, it's all as Clintons, and they were set up against each other as a Hegelian dialectic during the election in the States. So there seems to be certainly some sort of a bloodline connection with the Shayadin in Ince, right? And his family. And Lo Sanhedrin Galen was best.
About rabbis in Israel talking about the Messiah is near when Trump was elected. Trump saying he's going to figure out Israel and create peace in the Middle East. The concepts of royal Israeli bloodline coming through Europe as part of the narrative to present the Antichrist as the Bible suggests, claiming to be the long-awaited Jewish Messiah. And as a counterpoint to this whole rabbit trail, why is the Trump presidency so quiet on the topic of UFOs, aliens, and that whole thing, whereas previous presidents have all talked about this issue at the popular cultural level? And then the comparison of Trump to Reagan and all of his exploits politically. Remember, Reagan was the one who talked about the world would unify if we knew there was an outside threat, blah, blah, blah.
Threat to this world from some other species, from another planet, outside in the universe.
Well, do you remember Mikhail Gorbachev's response at the time? He said in Geneva, which is where CERN is, interestingly, that this incredible proposition is too early to worry about. Maybe Reagan jumped the gun on some sort of plot or agenda, where Trump is now at the helm to be the face, the leader, if you will, when this sort of change, this technological change, happens societally. And how is it going to be used as part of the alien deception, perhaps a Project Bluebeam? All these elements start to surface as we look at this. And so, again, lots of questions, obviously, but I want to leave the question to you. What do you think is actually going on here? What's up with Trump's lineage? What's up with the silence over the UFO topic in this presidency so far? Is there something crazy being planned, perhaps as a response to some sort of natural disaster? The questions go on and on and on. Again, let me know what you think in the comments section. Thanks for checking this out, guys. Age of Deceit 3 is still in the works. There's lots.
Again, I said it's interesting you should mention some sort of a natural disaster. We're anticipating that they'll stage it during the exit of this binary star system. As it exits, we're anticipating huge seismic events. And I guess, like I said, after World War III, it'll be followed by a contact by these sentient beings who will maybe perhaps try to mitigate and curb the destruction humanity will bring upon themselves. This will be the false narrative that they'll look to play out on us in order to lull a lot of the Umma into this belief that these are in fact our creators, our gods, and they're extraterrestrial in nature. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. Jazakallahu khairan wa sallam jazakallahu khairan wa sallamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.